Hello, everybody. This is James Lawrence, and I pray that things are going well for you and your family, whoever may be your loved ones or whoever may be your love of your life, which, of course, first and foremost should be Jesus Christ if you are a Christian. If you're not, I pray, God, that you will hear some things from the Word of God or a witness from someone that will cause you to be drawn to the Lord. And it will if you're sincere and you say, Lord, I'm seeking you. Tell me, are you real or are you not? And I believe he will definitely let you know. And if you try to draw close to God, and when I say try, our human frailties prevent us from doing as well as we could. Just like Jesus said about the disciples themselves, he said that the flesh is weak, even though your spirit is willing. And he said that in the Garden of Gethsemane when he was asking them to pray with him because he was about to be crucified. He had even told them, and they knew that this was coming. And they could not even pray with him an hour. They would fall asleep in the Garden of Gethsemane. But Jesus kept praying, and he prayed so intensely that his sweat became as drops of blood coming from him. So he was in extreme agony, knowing not only the terrible physical torture he would go through, but also taking on the sin of the world. This was a spiritual agony that none of us could ever understand. But he did that to free us from the sin nature, to save us from it, and to make us born again believers in him, or our spirits being renewed. Okay, so do believe the gospel that Jesus died for you on a cross, shedding his blood profusely for your sins, the remission of your sins, and afterward being placed in a tomb, being raised from the dead 3 days later so that you too could be raised from the dead and have eternal life with him, or to be raptured from this life, never seeing death. And I'm hoping that's the way I'll go, you know, because I don't fear death necessarily. What I fear is, how's it going to happen? You know, you don't know. So we all have some of that. It's natural. But we do know that we do have a time appointed unto us to die, as it says in the book of Hebrews. But after that, the judgment. So do know the Lord if you don't know him, and seek him in prayer and by studying his word if you don't know enough about him yet. And with that said, let me go to my subject now, and I'm titling this is the Russia War, Gog and Magog, or Armageddon. Is it either one? You might even add that to that title. But there's some interesting facts I want to point out, and I'm going to start with one that's really quite amazing. If you have not heard this or connected this, if you're have any scholarly ways about you where you've studied the word at times, especially on this subject. Pardon me. But it says that Russia recruits Syrians for battles in Ukraine. That was in the New York Post. We're now starting to see Bible prophecy openly stated in headline news. Okay, let me repeat that. Russia recruits Syrians for battles in Ukraine, New York Post. And then a similar title, Syria recruiting troops from its military to fight with Russian forces in Ukraine. And that was in the newspaper called The Guardian. Now in Psalm chapter 83, verse 5 through 8, it says this, with one mind they plot together, they form an alliance against you. Now, against you who? Israel. Anytime it's talking about that, it's always speaking from the viewpoint of Israel, if it's not speaking from the perspective of heaven and of Jesus being at the right hand of the Father, now being our intercessor. As the Bible says, since he's been raised from the dead, he ascended to the Heavenly Father, and he is seated at his right hand. That doesn't mean he's seated all the time. I believe Jesus walks in heaven, and he blesses the people there, you know, in many different ways that he does. But also, he may just stand at the right hand of the Father at times. Now, is it Stephen that was stoned in the book of Acts who said, "I see the Son of God standing at the right hand of the Father"? Now, I'm pretty sure he said standing. So, for a saint being martyred, especially a man who was full of the Holy Spirit and was giving a dissertation to people from Abraham all the way through to Jesus Christ, and it was so brilliantly given. It's amazing. It's the story of the Bible that Stephen gave in such a short amount of time. It was very anointed and so well spoken. And then they stoned him to death, the religious leaders of that time. They didn't like Stephen. They knew he was a great man of God, and he was taking some of their religious glory away from them. And so they stoned him to death. And he said, "I see the Son of Man, Son of God, standing at the right hand of the Father." He is called the Son of Man also. That's two different terms, Son of God, Son of Man. It's showing that he had his humanity and he had his godness that never left him when he came here. He may have not operated in his full capacity as God when he was here on earth. And some people have arguments about that, but folks, listen, just be realistic about it. Jesus did have to grow up under parents, Joseph being his stepfather, Mary being his actual mother, but the Holy Spirit of God being who conceived Jesus. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit. And that is a major point in the Bible. People who argue that or say, "Ah, we don't need to talk about that." Are you kidding? Don't go there. Yes, we do need to talk about it, because that was a very, very major event in biblical history. It's what all of the Old Testament led down to, was the birth of the Messiah. And so that is very important. But now, I read these two headlines about Syria joining Russia in this fight. Well, in the scripture in Psalm 83, 5 through 8, it says, "With one mind they plot together, they form an alliance against you," Israel, Jerusalem. Picking back up, it says, "The tents of Edom and the Ishmaelites of Moab and the Hagrites, Byblos, Ammon and Amalek, Philistia and the people of Tyre, even Assyria has joined them to reinforce Lot's descendants." To reinforce Lot's descendants. Assyrians consisted of, at that time, the people of the regions of Iraq, Turkey, and Syria. Okay, some people get confused and they say, "Assyrians, Assyria, that must have been Syria." Well, not really, but Syria, it consisted of Syria, Turkey, Iraq, okay? These nations that have, some of them, Iran and so forth, who have said that they want to wipe Israel off the map so that they don't exist anymore. They've had a hatred for them for thousands of years, literally. Now, I made a video back on November 4th of 2021. This was quite some time before the current Russian war with Ukraine began against Ukraine, because Russia instigated it. They perpetrated it. They executed it. So in this video, I want to approach the subject again. I pointed out the differences between Gog and Magog and Armageddon. The Gog and Magog war and the Battle of Armageddon, that war. And so let me mention those main differences again. I may add a few points as well. These are only the main points, because if I began to do a complete dissertation, a full teaching on this, you talk about being lengthy, there are people that are going to say, "Now I'm confused even more." So let me just talk about the main points of this, which I believe are, of course, very important. At Armageddon, Jesus will return, and his saints will follow behind him in massive numbers. According to Jude chapter 14, he says, "Behold, the Lord cometh with 10,000s, that's a plural thousands, many, many times a thousand, thousands of thousands, 10,000s of his saints to execute judgment on the ungodly. Okay, so they're coming back with Jesus. So they had to have went up to heaven before Jesus came back with them. Okay, so they come back, and this will be the Battle of Armageddon, in which at the culmination of that seven-year period of Great Tribulation, that's what it's called. It's a seven-year period. And there will be terrible things that happen during that time. Not only God's wrath on the earth, but also Satan's final attempt to unite the earth, the world, against Christ. Anti-Christ. Okay, so this will be the saved now. We are saved. Those who have died and gone on before us, their spirits are in heaven, but their spirits will meet with their bodies at the what's called the rapture, which is the sudden resurrection in the twinkling of an eye, one scripture says, and another one it says, we shall meet the Lord in the air. The dead in Christ shall rise first. Their bodies and their soul and spirit will connect with their newly made, beautiful, glorified body that shall never see decay, corruption, as the Bible calls it, or sickness, illness of any kind, anything, temptation to sin. All of that will be gone. Okay, so who are alive shall also go up at that time. It's called the rapture. They've made whole series out of it, novels and TV series, the Left Behind series of movies. Each one is a movie length thing, and it's about when the rapture happens and people are left behind. Okay, those who are left behind can be saved if they're not overwhelmed with the horror and the fear of showing that they are Christians and having the Antichrist system that will be on the earth, that will be established by Satan through a man called the Antichrist, also called the Beast and the Son of Perdition. Yes, I know there's a show that was on called Sons of Perdition and so forth, and that's all great and cool and everything like that. But there's going to be a real Son of Perdition, and he will be so wicked. There is no man. I mean, these guys, some of these guys that think they are so mighty and great on the earth, they could just be fried in a split second into dust. So they are not that powerful. They're human beings. These are spiritual beings that are extremely mighty and powerful, Satan being one of them. Okay, he was a mighty fallen angel who connected with man in the Garden of Eden so that he could gain part of his dominion on the earth. And so that's why we have a sin nature. It was a double exchange. We received part of what Satan is, the sin nature. He's fully sin. I mean, he's so opposite of God that everything you can think of, holiness, he's unholy. Good and, well, he's evil. Good, there's evil. Light, darkness. God, the devil. And so, therefore, these people think they're so magnificently powerful. Even these people that rose up, well, let me name one, Hitler. He rose up and he got many armies behind him. And who were they persecuting? Well, coincidentally, it was the Jewish people. Now you can say, now, James Lawrence, do you really mean that? No, I'm being sarcastic. Because it's just way too much of an occurrence to not be exactly what the scripture says about Israel being hated. Even without reason, people hate that nation. But it's a satanic influence on them. And Hitler became so enraged and just hatred towards the Jewish people that they say 12 million people is what I've heard. But I know 6 million is what I heard for a very long time. That's a huge number by itself. 6 million people exterminated, executed, killed, fried, burned, baked in ovens, gassed, and all that kind of stuff, and they were killed. Children, women, men. Why is Israel hated so badly? I can't explain it totally. There's a jealousy of that nation. people have a sense within them that God favors them, or they would not exist. They're too small. But they're very mighty at the same time because they have God's power on their side. Now, I was just talking about, so I don't get too sidelined here, it will be a seven-year period coming up called the Great Tribulation period, and that's when the Lord comes with 10,000s of his saints to execute judgment at the end of it, when Satan then gathers people to battle to go against Israel and against the saints in Israel, and the saints from heaven will come with Jesus and will destroy those armies. And it will really be Jesus, the brightness of his coming. They will literally, there will be so much brightness coming from him, it will be like nuclear or hydrogen power in these bombs, except something very different. It will be extremely powerful, and by the sword of his mouth, the word of his mouth is what it also means. And he will speak words to them. He will pronounce judgment on them, and they will drop dead. Okay, you've heard that saying, drop dead. This will be literal, okay? They will be cut in pieces. I mean, they will just be destroyed just so totally. I believe there will be a confusion like there was in other past armies that tried to go against God's people, the Hebrew children, who later became known as the Jewish people, the Israelites, as we also call them. And they became confused and actually began to strike at each other and kill each other. So God can cause that type of confusion in those that are against God. Now, let me go on though with this, but it will be a seven-year time when God's wrath and Satan's final attempt will be to destroy Israel and to intensely tempt Earth's population to join him in attempting to destroy Israel. That will be the Battle of Armageddon. Now, the reason Armageddon is not the war of Gog and Magog that the scriptures talk about is for the reasons I will state to you here in just a moment. But do remember that the Gog-Magog war could possibly come. Now, this is something I had thought of before years ago. Not knowing, you know, sometimes even thinking, is Gog, the war of Gog and Magog, just another description of the Battle of Armageddon? Some people say, yes, that is, they're one and the same. That's Armageddon. There are too many differences, folks. Too many. And I talked about that in that first video I put out about the differences between the Gog-Magog Wars and the Battle of Armageddon, which, like I say, I did that one back in November, early November of 2021. Now, these are the reasons I'm going to state to you why this cannot be the same war, but the war of Gog and Magog, as I heard one teacher very eloquently state, and I do believe he was led of God, I do. There are some men I kind of wonder, but this guy, I do believe he was teaching God's word for sure and with anointing. And he was talking about that there could be two Gog and Magog wars. In fact, he believes there is going to be. One of them, which is heating up right now. Now, here's what I'm thinking is also a possibility. Now, you say, why do scholars not know? You know what? I think there's a reason why some things will remain a mystery forever in this lifetime. Okay? Excuse the dogs barking really loud out there. Usually I can't hear those, but this time I'm hearing them. We'll forget about the dogs right now. But anyway, there are reasons why it could come in two phases, and here's what I mean by that. There could be a Gog-Magog uprising in which a lot of what's going to happen in the final war of Gog-Magog will happen. Here's why I believe that, and I think it's pretty strong reasons, folks. I don't see how people can see this in the Gog-Magog wars spoken of in the book of Revelation. It says that Christ will have reigned for 1,000 years on the earth. Okay, so it's at least 1,007 years away because the Great Tribulation hadn't started, the 70th week of Daniel. Now that's a whole different another thing, but it's a week of a week of years. In other words, there's 7 days in a week. Well, in the Great Tribulation period, it's the last of the times of Jacob's trouble, as it's called in the Old Testament. It will come in a 7-year period that will be the worst of all that has happened in those 70 weeks of years. This is the last 7 that will be transpiring. So this was something in the book of Daniel I just mentioned to you here. But anyway, the Bible comes on further into then the New Testament, and it talks about the Great Tribulation period, which Jesus said will be like no time the earth has ever seen, no, nor shall it ever see again. And so anyway, it's here. Let me go into some of these reasons I believe it could come in 2 phases. Both cases in which God, of course, does destroy these armies coming in against Israel on the earth. You see, Jesus will literally set up his kingdom on earth, and he will be in Jerusalem ruling the world with a rod of iron. We will be kings and priests and rule with him, the Bible says, on the earth, we who are saved now. So you need to get in that number when the saints come marching in with Jesus. But we will be on white horses and in white, clean linen that's so white, it's bright, shining white, as well as Jesus. And he will have a radiance that exudes from him that's the power of God. And it will destroy those armies at Armageddon. Now, I've already said that, but let me go forward here. In Ezekiel chapter 38, I'm going to read verses 2 through 4, and then I'm going to skip down to verse 9. It says, Son of man, talking to one of the prophets, set thy face against Gog of the land of Magog, the chief prince of Meshech and Tubal, and prophesy against him, and say, Thus saith the Lord God, Behold, I am against thee. Okay. Now it skips down. Now maybe it's verses 2, then 4, then 9. I'm trying to remember because I got dot, dot, dot between these, which means I'm trying to get to the gist of this prophecy is saying. Okay, I'm going to start over. Son of God, set thy face against Gog. Son of man, set thy face against Gog of the land of Magog, the chief prince of Meshech and Tubal, and prophesy against him and say, Thus saith the Lord God, Behold, I am against thee. And I will turn thee back and put hooks in thy jaws and will bring thee forth, and all thine army, horses and horsemen, all of them clothed with all sorts of armor. Thou shalt be like a cloud to cover the land, thou and all thy hordes. In other words, the armies in the parts of the north. Because it says in Ezekiel chapter 38, verse 15, that these armies will come from the parts of the north. And it is looking there from Jerusalem. And Russia is exactly the furthest north nation from Israel. Okay, at Armageddon, the armies will come from all the nations of the world. They'll be gathered against Jerusalem. Whereas it says here, it talks about these princes that, it talks about in Ezekiel 38, verse 15, that they're from the north. But it says that all nations of the world will be gathered together against Jerusalem at Armageddon. Zechariah 12:3 says, And in that day will I make Jerusalem a burdensome stone for all people. All that burden themselves with it shall be cut in pieces, though all the people of the earth be gathered together against it. All the people of the earth. Gog and Magog war will take place in the mountains of Israel, while Armageddon battle will be in the valley of Megiddo. Okay, so see, there's one difference there. Okay, the Armageddon battle involves all peoples and all nations, but Gog and Magog, that war will involve certain nations led by Russia. Okay, China is not one of the armies in the Gog and Magog war, but it will be involved in the Armageddon battle. Now, there's even a scripture that says about these people gathering together as an army to bring war against Jerusalem. And it says the number of them is 200 million. Okay. And John said, and I heard the number. He said it that way. He said, and I heard the number. 200 million will be coming against Israel. That's a huge number, folks. I don't know if there was 200 million people in the whole world back then. Why would the Holy Bible, if it is not inspired by God, if it wasn't, why would they have the why would they have the risk, would take the risk of saying there's going to be a 200 million man army in addition to these others that will be fighting? It wouldn't. It had to be revealed by the Holy Ghost, the Holy Spirit of God. Okay, the Antichrist is the major leader in the Battle of Armageddon. But the Antichrist is not seen. The Antichrist is not seen at the Gog and Magog battle, which is led by Gog, the ruler of the northern confederate of nations that will come against Israel. Okay, Jesus Christ stands on the Mount of Olives at the end of the Armageddon battle, because he'll then begin his thousand-year reign. I talked about the millennial reign, as we call it, on earth. But Jesus doesn't appear to the world during the Gog and Magog war. You know, he doesn't make a special appearance, in other words, if that makes sense. At Gog and Magog, the want-to-be invaders of Israel will be killed by a fire that comes down from God out of heaven. This is spoken in the book of Revelation. But at Armageddon, now I meant to put the scripture down, forgive me, I didn't, but it's in the other. If you listen to my other one about the differences between the Gog Magog and the Battle of Armageddon wars and the Armageddon wars, you will hear this me talk about that scripture. Okay? Where it says that fire shall come down from God out of heaven, because they shall try to come against the encampment of Israel and the saints, that fire shall come down from God out of heaven and destroy them. Well, that's different from hearing that Satan is destroyed in the Antichrist and the armies. Now, Satan's not destroyed, he's imprisoned. Now, I'll back up and say that. Because sometimes I get Antichrist and Satan confused, but the Antichrist is a person. He's a very charming, very intense leader, kind of like Hitler, but I think he'll have more charm and will draw more people in, because he will speak flattering words and so forth. I know I've read that somewhere also in the scriptures, but let me read this part again. At Gog and Magog, the want-to-be invaders of Israel will be killed by a fire that comes down from God out of heaven, but at Armageddon, the armies are destroyed by the brightness of Christ's coming back to earth after 7 years of Antichrist rule, his system, the Antichrist system on earth, and by the sword of his mouth. I almost said sword, didn't I? And by the sword or word of his mouth. Okay, that's what I believe, because the Bible says for us to take the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God. And that is in Ephesians chapter 6. You can find that. It's part of our armor. Okay? So anyway, this is what Jesus does. He destroys them by the literal exuding blast of his presence. Just whew, like huge numbers of hydrogen bombs going off at once, and they just fold over dead. They'll die even as they stand on their feet. They'll be melted, and then they will fall backwards, but their flesh will still be there. Enough of it will be there, and their blood for the birds of the heavens to come down and eat their eat their flesh and their blood and so forth off of them. It's the great feast of the Lord for the fowl of the air. That sounds strange, but it's true. It's in the book of Revelation. There's many strange things in our minds in the Holy Bible, but they're true. So folks, let me back up again and say this. Could it be, in conclusion, could it possibly be that the Gog and Magog war is something that's taking place, building up now, but then as time goes by, all these places will reform, they'll gather back together, and Israel itself, the Jews even more so, will gather into the nation of Israel for any type of future thing that could happen. They want to be together as a family again. And the Bible says that. It even says that in I think it's the 38th chapter of Ezekiel. Or is it? Well, there's another prophet that spoke about the gathering of Israel back to its nation. And there's been a couple of wars. The one in 1940, when they gathered back together in their nation in 1948. Was it 47, 48? I think it's 1948. And then in 1967, there was the Six-Day War. And they said that that was a literal miracle war in which Israel defended itself and destroyed the other armies and stayed a nation when they were trying to be overthrown by these other nations that came against them. Well, that's going to happen again because it's a continual thing. They are hated among all nations for Christ's sake. He said that in Matthew 24. And ye shall be hated of all nations for my name's sake. A lot of it may have to do with differences in so-called religions. There are certain religions that are actually have more people in them than does Christianity or Judaism. And I know that sounds strange, but it says that though they be the smallest seed in the earth, yet will they grow into the greatest nation that has ever existed. They actually are now, spiritually speaking, for the kingdom of God has come to us from Jesus Christ spiritually. And you say, spiritually? Well, then it's all going to be spiritual. No, it's not. It's going to be physical too. But pretty soon everything will be made spirit again, and God will rule the earth forever. Well, now let me put it this way. He will be the one who we will worship forever as the creator of everything. That he will be our loving Heavenly Father. That's when the new heaven and the new earth are made. That's after all these battles take place. And then shall the new Jerusalem come down from heaven, from God, out of heaven, and shall land upon the earth, and we shall dwell with God forever. And listen, folks, it's not going to be a clouds and let's play harps all the time, or maybe sing in a choir all the time. We may do all those things and enjoy them thoroughly. But what I'm saying is there's going to be so much more to heaven. And listen, the main thing is we're going to want to bow to the Lord. It's going to feel so good as it does now to us who are Christians. Glory be to you, Father God. I love you so much. Hallelujah for your mercies and your graciousness and for saving us freely through your Son Jesus, not of anything that we have done, but through your Lord, before our Lord. The Lord says to his Lord, I will make thee Lord, and I will put all things under my foot. The last enemy that shall be put to death, put under his feet shall be death. So there will be no more death at a certain point ever again. But again, folks, let me end it again saying this. There is, end it again. Let me try to get to the end again by saying that there could be an uprising that is so very similar to the Gog Magog wars, that you could call it that, that's going to happen in these times, and that it could be very severe. They're already talking about that it could just almost at the snap of a finger, just in an instant of time, it could turn into World War III. Okay, but will that Gog Magog war be the one that kind of ends all battles? You know, in the book of Revelation, it says after Jesus reigns 1,000 years, that Satan, who will have been bound for 1,000 years in the bottomless pit, and with a seal upon there that he shall not be released from there till the 1,000-year reign of Jesus is concluded. Then shall he be released for a little season to deceive the nations one final time. And it says that those armies will be destroyed. So there's always rebelliousness in men, especially when Satan can have any place in them at all. Give no place to the devil, the Bible says. So if they are able to still give even a tiniest little, just like Jesus compared faith to a grain of mustard seed, it can be that small and have tremendous power. Well, you can have just a grain of mustard seed size place that you give to the enemy, and he will rush in like an army and take you with him to whatever battles he wants to go to, because you're deceived and you're following him thinking he's going to win. He's not going to win. For those of you who are not saved, it's not even possible. God is so much more powerful. Folks, Satan's a created being, and all these people are created beings. God could wrap up the whole earth and just crumble it into nothing and be done with it. But he loves the man he created, the man, woman, child, all of us. He loves us very much, and he wants us to live. He does, in fact. Okay, and he wants us to live with him for eternity because he wants us to be his continued family from this world into the next. And we will be. Praise God. Hallelujah. So remember that, folks, that there's just differences, you know. Satan won't gather these armies together at the final Gog and Magog war until the end of the great, the mighty rule of Jesus Christ on the earth. Yes, after the Great Tribulation, because that's when the War of Armageddon is defeated by Christ and his armies, the saints. Then we shall reign with Christ on earth for 1,000 years. It comes, I mean, it's so much in place there. And then Satan, while the Antichrist and the false prophet, his sidekick, the Antichrist that shows wonders and signs that says, you must worship this great man, and so forth, while they will be destroyed by being cast into the lake of fire and to be tormented forever. They won't be dissolved. They'll be tormented forever and ever. Then, once they're cast away and Satan is put in the pit, he is later also cast into the lake of fire to be destroyed forever. But God's going to reserve him there to make that attempt one more time to overthrow Jerusalem and Israel, because God wants to eliminate all rebelliousness and sinfulness in mankind and to do away with the one who has been causing this terrible union of Satan and man, the sin nature, and for it to be gone forever from the universe. And he's going to do it very thoroughly. Okay? God bless you for hearing me. I must end it there. Praise God. Hallelujah. The Lord Jesus is Lord. Make him your Lord today. Thank you so very much. And I'll talk to you again soon. This is James Lawrence saying goodbye for now.